This all started in a cave in the desert, with one man clanking away on a suit of armor. And from there, the world started to grow and grow and grow. And after a decade of storytelling, we're finally here. We're in the endgame now. And yes, this is a super spoilery discussion of the movie, so if you haven't seen it yet, then go. Like, seriously, go right now. This is one that is worth seeing in theaters. Several times. Now, this isn't going to be a plot summary review like a lot of other channels do, mainly because that is what a lot of other channels do, and you've probably had the plot of the movie repeated at you several times by now. From the beginning, where we see all of our heroes coping with their loss, to Ant-Man kicking off the time heist that's full of great character moments and fan service, to a final battle that's as full of ups and downs as the Battle of Minas Tirith and Return of the King. It's just great. The only nitpick I really have is that the time travel rules don't really make sense by the end of the movie, but time travel never really makes sense anyway. And if Legends of Tomorrow has taught me anything, it's that chaos through time is fun, so just roll with it. So, if this review isn't about me printing off the wiki summary of the movie and taking you through it plot point by plot point, then what is it? Well, like the movie itself, I want to focus on character. Because really, at its core, that's what Endgame is. Amidst all of the immense, epic-level action, it's a character story closing the arcs that began 10 years ago with the original six Avengers. Over the last decade, we've gotten to know and root for all of these characters, and by now, there probably isn't a person on the face of planet Earth who doesn't know who they are. And that is totally crazy if you think about it. Back in 2008, only hardcore comic fans even knew who characters like Black Widow or Hawkeye were. But over these 22 movies, they've become so much more than just characters from the comics. They've become a part of this global cultural canon. From China to the US to Europe to all the way down here in Australia, everyone knows who these characters are now. And that's a great statement for how well Marvel has been doing with all of these movies, but it's also a lot of pressure. The pressure that would have weighed down on the Russo brothers and the screenwriters Christopher Marcus and Stephen McFeely for this movie would have been crushing. How do you close a decade-spanning story in a way that satisfies hundreds of millions of fans all around the world? Well, the answer is the way they did it here. By snapping away so many of the new heroes in Infinity War, they gave themselves a chance to focus on the original team of six Avengers. For most of its running time, Endgame really is all about Hawkeye, Black Widow, the Hulk, Thor, Captain America, and Iron Man. And that is the perfect setup for concluding this chapter of the Marvel story. Not only do we as an audience get to celebrate one last ride with these characters that we've come to know and love, but they get the narrative focus to give them a satisfying conclusion despite how big the world of Marvel has become. And through the time travel elements, they took us back, allowing us to revisit some of our favorite moments from MCU history. Whether it's the Avengers assembling for the first time in New York or Captain America's elevator fight scene, we get to relive some of the moments that forged our connection with these characters. All the while moving the plot forward and giving poignant, powerful character beats to our heroes before they head off into the final confrontation. So let's dive into those character moments where the movie truly shines. First up, let's brush past the one the movie also kind of just brushes past, and that's Bruce Banner. His arc was pretty much concluded off-screen in the 5-year time jump after the snap. After spending most of his adult life fighting with the Hulk, he's finally reconciled with his inner demon. And that means that he now gets the best of both worlds, all of the brawn of the Hulk and all of the smarts of Bruce Banner. It reminded me a lot of the X-Men's Beast, and it was a nice, wholesome way to bring the character arc to a satisfying conclusion. I just wish more of that arc had been in this movie, but it is already 3 hours long, and ultimately I think the decision was fine because it built off the character journey he'd begun in Thor Ragnarok and Avengers Infinity War. But let's move on to the good stuff. Black Widow. In the MCU, she is almost as foundational as Iron Man. She is the second superhero we meet alongside Rhodey's War Machine. She's been there since almost the beginning, and across the years, we've seen her go from a spy loyal to S.H.I.E.L.D. to the woman who helped Cap take down S.H.I.E.L.D. to pretty much the mother hen for a group of kooky Avengers that now include a superpowered spacewoman and a talking raccoon. In essence, she went from someone who had no family to the point of not even knowing who her own father was, to someone who found one. From someone who only really cared about her next mission, to someone who cared deeply about the people she loved. And that whole arc culminates when she sacrifices herself for our next character, Hawkeye. Here in Endgame, the relationship we'd seen established between these two characters in the original Avengers movie is flipped. Hawkeye was a caring person. He brought Natasha Romanoff to S.H.I.E.L.D. because he could see the good in her, and ultimately that saved her. But in Endgame, those roles are reversed. After losing his family, Hawkeye becomes a killing machine, traveling the globe and killing criminals Punisher style. But Natasha can still see the good in him, and like he saved her all those years ago, she sacrifices herself and saves him. And at the end of the movie, Clint Barton gets to see his family again because of that sacrifice. It's such a perfect dual arc for the pair of them, and it means all the more because her death was for something. It was done out of love and for the future of the people that she loved. And that is where I cried like a baby for the first time in the movie. But now to get to our main trio, and I've been trying to avoid cursing in most of my newer videos, but holy shit, this is some great fucking stuff. It is just amazing. First up, Thor. When we find him again after the time jump, he is a broken man. Everyone he's ever loved is gone. From his mother, to his father, to his brother, to all of his best friends, it is actually crazy how many people he has lost. On top of all of that loss, he failed in Infinity War. He didn't go for the head, and because of that, the whole universe suffered. So, in a totally broken state, he's stopped taking care of himself. He's become an alcoholic who never leaves the house and plays video games all day. And I think that feeling so broken that you stop taking care of yourself is something that a lot of people have faced in one way or another throughout their lives. Or at least it's something I could relate to. But ultimately, after a beautiful moment where he gets to reunite with his mother one last time, he learns that he is still worthy. Despite how he feels like a failure, despite how he looks on the outside, it's what's inside that matters. And Mjolnir decides he is worthy. His mother helps him learn that he needs to discover himself, find out what he really wants, instead of taking on the responsibility thrust upon him by others, and especially his father, Odin.
You're ready. The time has come for you to take the throne. Embrace and celebrate what you've won. Join your warriors. Eat and drink. Revel in their celebration.
And so he cleans himself up, he puts Valkyrie in charge of Asgard, and he joins the biggest group of misfits in the MCU, the Asgardians of the Galaxy. Together with them, he might just discover who he's really meant to be. But Star-Lord is still in charge. Of course. Of course. Of course. Then we get to Cap. Was this the best Christmas present ever? Yes. As the movie points out, some people move on, but not Cap. In the 5-year gap since the snap, he's been helping people move on from their loss, but he's never even moved on from his first loss, all the way back in the 40s when he was still punching Nazis. So it's no wonder that he's ready to lay it all on the line to make things right.
This is the fight of our lives.
This is gonna work, Steve.
I know it is. Because I don't know what I'm gonna do if it doesn't.
He loses his shield, breaks his arm, picks up a meow meow, and even after saving the whole goddamn universe, he is in for one last mission to go put the Infinity Stones back where they're supposed to be. But he never did move on from that first loss, that dance he never got to have with Peggy Carter. And so he stays behind. He goes to get that dance and get the girl, and he can finally put his shield down, and after a lifetime of fighting, he can finally rest. He lives a life. Since the beginning, this is a character who has taken the weight of the world on his shoulders, and even though he can barely measure up to some of the cosmic powers that he's faced, he has never once flinched. He planted himself like a tree and told the world, "No, you move." But after a lifetime of battle and struggle, he finally rests. And it's a beautiful, heartwarming ending for a character who has truly become the beating heart of this first chapter of the MCU. Now, Cap may have been that beating heart, but he's not the one who started it all. That would be Tony, I am Iron Man, Stark.
I am Iron Man.
Over the course of these movies, we've watched Tony go from a selfish playboy billionaire to a superhero who wants to build a suit of armor around the world. And with all of that pressure he put on himself came mistakes. Ultron, then the Civil War, and ultimately, the snap. Those mistakes cost the world a lot, but Tony was lucky. He got home and the love of his life was okay, and over the course of the 5 years, they had a daughter. Once the plot of Endgame kicks off, Tony really is the only one who has anything left to lose. But he goes along with the time heist plan anyway, because it's the right thing to do. And in the end, they win, but he does lose. He saves the world, but loses his life. And at that point in the movie, we get a beautiful moment where Pepper kneels down next to him and lets him know we're going to be okay. And that's where I broke down for the third time in the movie. Because as he's lying there, slowly wasting away, that is the last thing he hears. He knows that they won. He knows that the journey that he started all those years ago in a cave in the desert is finally over, and he succeeded.
Thank you for saving me. Don't waste your life.
He was a suit of armor around the world, and he kept what he loved safe. And along the way, he got to have one real human moment with his father, the thing that he'd always really wanted. When the first Iron Man came out, I was 16, and I loved it, but for probably all of the wrong reasons. Reasons teenagers love movies. Tony Stark was cool, he drank booze, he slept with girls, and he killed terrorists. But as I grew up, the MCU and Tony grew up with me, and for that journey to end in such a beautiful way, a way that shows how far Tony has come and all of the good that he's inspired in the world, well, it speaks to the strength of the storytelling the MCU has, to the power of what Marvel has achieved here. It is something truly unprecedented in the history of film. They told one long-form narrative over 11 years, and in this movie they reaped all the rewards of that. Over those years, people all around the world have grown deeply attached to these characters, and in turn these characters have grown themselves, ultimately becoming the heroes who won the Endgame. Through all of those characters, Marvel explored different genres and different corners of their universe and brought all of those disparate parts together for one superb final chapter. There has never been anything like this before in film. Sure, there have been other series like Harry Potter or Lord of the Rings, but those already had a deeply popular, established fan base and just retold a story in film form. Though, of course, a few things changed, they were based directly off their books. But the MCU earned most of its fans. Sure, the characters are all based off of their comic book counterparts, but I can guarantee you that any Marvel purist out there will tell you that they're not all that accurate. The comics here are not gospel at all. Instead, the MCU was built from the ground up to be a movie series, not beholden to the works from which the characters are derived. Not only that, but again, when this whole MCU thing started, no one knew who these characters were. People at the time called Avengers like Iron Man and Thor B-list heroes. And that makes what the MCU has achieved so much more powerful. You may be wondering what that second time I broke down into tears like a baby was. And it was in that moment, that superb, immense moment where all of the heroes come back to help Cap. All of the heroes from across 22 movies and all of the people they've worked to save. Asgardians, Ravagers, Wakandans, they were all there. From little street-level Spider-Man to magic-wielding sorcerers like Doctor Strange to cosmic Guardians of the Galaxy, anyone who we cared about as an audience that mattered to us was there. That magical, unprecedented moment was earned over the last 11 years of storytelling. I've seen the movie twice now, and I can tell you that during that scene, in both viewings, the audience erupted into cheers the likes I have never heard in a movie theater before. And so I was crying and I had goosebumps, and it's all very embarrassing, but that is the point. What the MCU has accomplished is insane. And Endgame is something that might never happen again in cinema history. It is a good movie, but it wouldn't be as astounding as a standalone film. It's astounding because of that long-form narrative that Marvel committed to all of those years ago. In that time, we've grown to care for and appreciate so many of these characters that it's impossible not to cheer when they all come roaring back onto the screen together. Endgame is a masterpiece, but not one that stands on its own. It's a masterpiece that only works because of the last decade of storytelling. And for me, that makes it all the more special. So something the movie kind of glossed over is that when Spider-Man comes back, he kind of makes it seem like everyone who was snapped didn't really get much of a time gap. So I can imagine there are gonna be a lot of awkward conversations. At the start of the movie, we see a support group where people are trying to move on, and one of the guys there is dating again after losing his husband. What about the people who were faster to move on? What about the people who remarried and have kids with other people now? It's gonna be a lot of awkward conversations, and I would pay for a Disney streaming service show that was all about those terrible, cringy situations. Marvel, if you need a writer, hit me up.